Beginning our daf is Masechta Yevamos Daf Tzadi Zayin. Begin the level lines down at the top of the Yomi, where we finish up the Parakei Shirabo, explain the halacha, comparing that of a 9-year-old to a 20-year-old who didn't bring Beis Cyrus. And then we'll begin the next parak, continuing the 11th parak, parak Nisna al Nusa. Today's daf we're going to discuss with the next parak regarding if a person marries a woman, he becomes forbidden to our relatives. Even if they're no longer married, but if a person seduced a woman, that's the title of the parak, Nisna ala Nusa, then he does not become forbidden to our relatives. Nevertheless, that she's still alive, then it would still be Asur Midrabban. We're also talking about Anusa, so Mefutas of it, regarding the Chum hold that even then this does not apply. Midrabban holds that this does apply to if the woman that his father seduced, who wasn't married to, but he was intimate with. And Gershon Eskar, Kakan Janel Dami, regarding the classic Talmudic dictum that a ger that converts is like a child, and the ramifications regarding as it relates to relationships of these gear. So we begin the current daf tzadik zayin, after the two dads, echad, going on the last words of the Mishnah, of this whole string of theme of the ben teshan of b'chulu, from the 9-year-old. So etc. The Mishnah said that this halach is not just for a 9-year-old; it's also for a 20-year-old even. If he didn't bring Beis Cyrus, he's still like a minor. So the Gemara says, really, is that really so? But it seems to be contrary to the Mishnah. Mishnah is needed. Mishnah says, Ben Esim Shana Shalehi Bishdei Sayyidah, we have a 20-year-old man who didn't bring two pubic hairs. Yevil Raya, so let him bring a proof to Ben Esim that he's over 20, who has Sagas, and that means he's a eunuch, he can't have children. So then, Lachel Zvamiyam doesn't do Nachalit, not Yibim, and the Rashi explains the reason is because he can't have children. And the whole point of Yibim is to be Hakim Lachim Shem. So as Rashi explains the Gemara's question, obviously you see that the 20-year-old is like a gadol. And we don't say that he's a child and wait for him, that he might mature and be able to have a child. Aren't you telling me that when he's 20, he's like a cotton? But if that would be the case, why he's saying that, okay, let the wife go, let the Yavama go scot-free? Similarly, the Mishnah says over there, Bas Esim Shonam Shleibi Yishtei Seiris. The main question is from the first half, but we just quote the whole thing. If you have a 20-year-old woman who didn't make two pubic kids, Yavirai Shibas Esim, bring proof that she's already 20, go check up the birth records. The Islandess, obviously she's an Islandess. So let's mom's remembrances and you don't do this. There's no chalit, no yim. Let her go scot free. The whole point is to make a child from the widow. So again, like Rashi explained, the Gemara's question is, didn't you tell me the Mishnah that a 20-year-old is the same like a 9-year-old? Which means you would wait till they mature, but aren't you telling me the Mishnah itself is needed that a 20-year-old is already an adult, is just not capable? So the Gemara says a very important concept. Hayit ma law, but we said on that, Amar Shmuel b'Yitzchak Amaral, but who? This that we learned the Mishnah itself is needed. That we consider the 20-year-old as an adult, but won't be capable of having children, that's specifically Shenobodai Simoni Sages, that he developed symptoms of Sages, of not being able to have children. Oh, it's obvious that the reason why he didn't make two pubic hairs is because he's a Sages. Someone who can't have children, a lot of times does not have signs of maturation. But as long as we don't see any other signs of Sereses, oh, we suspend it on because he's immature. And we're concerned that maybe the adulthood will come at some point. As we know, we have young adults that are still like teenagers these days. You know, the maturity, that's emotional development, but even the physical development also, it delays. And therefore, that's the difference between the two cases, between our Mishnah and Mishnah Mesetas Nida. And Amar Rabbi says, take it Nami, if you're precise, you'll see the Ktani, the Mishnah of the Mesetas Nida said these words, Buhu Asadas. What do you mean, Buhu Asadas? What do those words mean? Shema Mino, that obviously it's telling us, because he had signs of Sadas, and he doesn't have two people, because, okay, Gagarin is over. But, of course, like our Mishnah said, a 20-year-old man will be the same thing as a 9-year-old boy that we would wait if there's no Simani Sagas. Says the Gemara, okay, so so like you're saying in our Mishnah, if there's no signs of Schisis, then we're going to consider him just like a 9-year-old boy, Sa'ad Kama. How long will he be considered as a young boy? So says the Gemara, Tonim Berbechia, Tonim Bryce Bashir Berbechia, Ad Reib Shanaisa. Until the majority of a person's years, which the person's life is considered 70 years until 36. Then already you say, okay, gigangin. You're not a young boy anymore. We're not expecting you anymore to develop into an adult. That already would be change the halacha. He would already be considered as a gadol at that point. Now, lemaisa, the Gemara ends off by saying, ki asu, when they would bring a 20-year-old male who didn't bring pubic hairs, like Hamein Dadav and Rav Dadav to check. Is it because he's still immature, or because he's a Sages, which obviously has huge ramifications regarding Yibam Chalitza and regarding like the halachas of our Mishnah? So, Ikachash, if it's very lean, Amlo, he would tell them, Zilav Ryu, go fatten him up. Give him to eat, give him to drink until he becomes healthy and robust. The bari, if he was very healthy, he was large, I'm going to tell him, zilak chashu, go, put him on some intermittent fasting. Let's lean him up a little bit. Because he explained the hanis amanim, these signs, the pubic ears, zimna denas rumacha makmas kichishusa, ironically, but sometimes they fall out because a person's very lean, as our dada, daf esna bisluma, you know, bisluma gizint, and therefore they fall out because there's no vitality in the person. Zimna denas rumacha makmas, and they fall out because a person is too fat, and therefore it's not maintaining the ability of having the pubic ears. So he would ultimately tell them either way, either put on some weight or take over some weight. So then we'll see if, let's say, you know, you'll be able to develop these two pupil gears or not. Hanlochit Rebbe, which I return to you, the 10th paragraph of Masechta Yevamot, Paragisha Rabba, which spoke about primarily the reports of someone dying and some related halachas of Yevam. And with that, we begin the 11th paragraph of Masechta Yevamot, Parag Nusin Ala Nusin, which Shesa says, what's the relationship between this and the previous paragraph? So since we mentioned the previous paragraph, Nusin Rabba, Nafsadahim and Al, that marrying the sister, so to speak, or laying with the sister, does not make the wife forbidden. So we also in this parak teach that if he violates a woman, he's permitted to marry her relatives. So you see that having a forbidden relationship with one does not necessarily make, if it was out of wedlock, make it forbidden on the relative. So now we begin. Nice nala nusav al mafuta. After a person violated or seduced a woman, he's permitted to marry her daughter, her sister, her mother. He's permitted to marry the relatives of the woman that he seduced. But the other way around, not the case. Ha'inis v'amafata al ha'nesu'a, if someone goes and rapes or seduces a relative of a woman that he's married to, that's chayv, he would be liable. That's an erevatim. So it only works one way, not the other one. If he raped or seduced a woman, he'd be able to get married to that relative. But if he has a relative he's married to, he would not be able to, he would be liable if he raped or seduces that woman because that's an erevatim. So to continue the Mishnah, a person is allowed to marry the woman that his father raped or seduced, or if the one that his son violated or seduced. Yehuda, however, says it's forbidden in the woman that his father seduced or raped. The Gemara is going to explain the reasoning of Rabbi Yehuda. But says the Gemara, regarding the ratio of the Mishnah, this is what we learned in the Brisa. On the Seisha, the man violated a woman, so Elizabeth is permitted to marry her daughter. Not the Isha, but if he married a woman, then not Elizabeth, then he's permitted to marry the daughter. That's like what we said in the Halacha, the Mishnah, but just saying it straight out, that marrying is different than not marrying. But since he married a man, there seems to be contradicting the following Brisa. Brisa says, Hanita, if someone is suspected, there's rumors about him, min the Isha, regarding him having a relationship with this woman, so asa be'imo b'bita b'chisa. He's not allowed to get married to the mother, to the daughter, to the sister. Wait a second. So what? Well, obviously, the rumors that's going on is that he didn't get married. Obviously, he was fooling around with her. So, but you told me that anusas neisnal anusa mamafut. What's the problem? Why can't he marry the sister, the mother? What's the difference? Says, so, well, you're right, but that's midrabana. Of course, you're allowed to. But rabbinically, we're concerned that maybe if we're going to let you marry the daughter, guess what? That first love that you have, that woman that you were fooling around with, it's going to be around at every family simcha, wherever you're going for Shabbos. And now, you're going to continue having an out-of-wedlock relationship with her, and you're already married to a relative. Oh, that's problematic. That's already an erev d'oraisa. So then rabbinically, we don't let you marry the relative. So the Gemara says, I don't understand. Whenever you have something that's rabbinically forbidden, you would say that a terminology, the opening word of our parak, of our Mishnah was, noisin. How can you say a liketchila terminology of you're allowed to get married? If rabbinically you're not allowed to, how can you say nice? Which Tosfos says really you could have asked from the Braisa also, it says mutter. It's just we prefer to ask from the Mishnah. But how can you say you're allowed to get married to the anus's relative if you tell me rabbinically you're not allowed because we're concerned? It says the Gemara, Kitnan Masnin, when we learn the love of the Mishnah is La'achar Misa. We're talking about where the woman that he violated or seduced already died. We don't have to be concerned anymore by the family simchas, by Shabbos, by parties and this and that you're going to have that woman that you had mezana with, that she might be around. But you're right, if she's alive, you're right, we wouldn't say you could marry the relative of the woman that you raped, that you seduced, because of the inappropriateness. Okay, says Imam Anan, where do we know this, the source of the heter of our Mishnah, that the Isser is only, it's only an erva for a woman that you married, not that you were just intimate with. The term of the Brisa. Because Bekulam, by all that rise in Parashat Kedoshim, let's say his daughter-in-law, his aunt, another man, an animal, by all the nemeshchiv, it says the terminology of laying, which is carnally laying. But can't over here, by the mother and the wife, and by the relatives which are forbidden to because of his wife, nemer kicha, it says the terminology of taking. It says ish ki yikach es isha bes ima. It says v'isha lachis leisika, when it talks about his mother-in-law, when it talks about his sister-in-law. It says kicha. Why? Lamecha to tell you, derech lekucha nasotai, the Torah is only making it forbidden if it was through a way of a kinyan, of a taking. Where the first one was lukuchasai. Then he's liable for the second one when he has relations with her. Because, as Rashi explained, you can't say it's only when the second one is likuchin, because we know two conditions not typhus in the nerva. So obviously it means to say when you do the kicha on the first one, then the mother or then the sister is going to be forbidden. Says Gemara, how could you say that? Only a Papa Labai says, if that's the case, by the prohibition of having a relation with a sister. It says, if a man's going to take his sister, that's either the father's daughter or the mother's daughter, you think here also, it's only forbidden to marry the sister, but that's not the iser? How can you say that? Amalei says, no, come on. You're right. It says in the Torah, unspecified, take it. The one that's fit for a kinyan, so it means referring a kicha of a kinyan, like Tosfos explains. From the fact that it didn't use the regular terminology of shchiva, it sounds like it's telling us a drasha to tell us that the isra is only derech lekuchen when there was actually a marriage, and if it's coming to exclude a case of einzim. But haroi leshchiva, that which you cannot say, it literally means to say a lekicha, as Tosfos explains, because when you say kicha chesachisai, no one's going to make the mistake to think to say it means kicha. Obviously it means shchiva, because everyone knows kicha is not teifas and not chesai, it can't be a lekicha, can't be an actual that marriage that you did in the sister, so that's shchiva, that means shchiva. So don't ask me. That's, you know, we know that. But when it could be, and it would make sense in Tarasha, then that means it's specifically through marriage. That's when the relatives, the mother, the sister, that they're going to be forbidden only when you marry that woman. That's one approach. Another approach, Rav Almei says, Anas Isha, the halacha that if a man violates a woman, the mutalisi bitin, there's a lot of marry the daughter. He says mahacha. He brings the source from over here. Ksiv, it says a pasim yikur. This is a little more complex, but the ksiv, it says a pasim yikur. Ervas bas bincha bas bitcha leisigal. It says the erva, which means the relation of your son's daughter or your daughter's daughter, you're not allowed to marry. Now the inference is that's your son's daughter or your daughter's daughter. Habas benot dida. But let's say it's your wife's daughter's daughter or your wife's son's daughter, Gully, that sounds like that you would be permitted to get married to. That's what it sounds like. It's saying yours. Okay. Problem is, except there's a pasuk later on that says, Eves Isha Bita Lesigala, one's not like get married to a woman and her daughter, as Basbanav as Basbita Lesigach. You're not allowed marry her son's daughter or daughter's daughter. So, okay, so how do you resolve it? One pasuk seems to be indicating only your daughter's daughter and your son's daughter forbidden, but hers would be permitted. Other pasuk is explicitly, but even her son's daughter and the daughter's daughter. So how do we resolve this? Aha! Says Rava, I'll tell you. Kan ba'ainsin. When a man has a woman that he violated, that he raped, her son's daughter from another man, you're allowed to marry, because she wasn't your wife. Kan b'nisuin. But when you marry a woman, her, meaning your stepchildren, her children from another marriage, her son's daughter and daughter's daughter, yes, that's going to be forbidden. So therefore, that's how you resolve the psukim. And you see, but one pasuk is telling you that when it's through anusa, it's going to be permitted. So you see this concept that if it wasn't through marriage, you're permitted to other relatives. It says, wait a second, epachanon. Maybe say the exact opposite of what you're saying. Maybe when it says your son's daughter, which is a miyat, excluding her son's daughter, maybe that's talking about when you married her, that actually then, that's actually when you are permitted in her relatives. The other pasuk that's saying it's forbidden in explicitly in the pasuk to her son's daughter, maybe that's when it's not from him. Maybe that's talking about when he raped her. Maybe that woman's relatives are actually going to be forbidden. Which Tosfos explains, why would you say that? Because on the other hand, you could say that there's more reason to say it's going to be us and our relatives when he raped her. Because since he did it, Esther, and he was violating what it says, that Amala or Zima, because having licentious relationships, seducing or raping a woman, is immoral. So maybe that's when we say the relatives are forbidden. But when he married a woman, he didn't do anything wrong. Maybe then her relatives would not be forbidden. So maybe it's saying the exact opposite of what you're trying to prove. Says the Gemara, no, you can't say it because Araya She'er Ksibu. In these Arayas, it says the terminology She'er. But Nisuin Iker She'er. In marriage, there is She'er. That's when you become a She'er, and therefore that's a wife who he's married to. That's where the Pasuk is saying that the relatives are going to be forbidden. But Einzin, like a She'er, by a woman that he raped, there's no She'er, there's no marriage, and therefore that can't be the case. That it be forbidden, and again, that's the second source for this halacha by Mishnah of Nusna al Anusa, that the relatives of the Anusa are going to be permitted to marry. Now, then the Mishnah went through the second half regarding the father's Anusa and the father's Mefuta. So, in the Mishnah, it had Rabbi Huda that he said, Eisav Anusa av v'chulu. Tanna Kama says, you're allowed to marry the woman that the father seduced or raped? He says, no, it's forbidden. So, Rabbi Gidl Amar Rav, he says, my time to read, what's the reason Rabbi Huda that he says it's forbidden? Because it says the pasuk in the bottom. So the ikach ishah of a man not allowed to take his father's wife, and then it says legal kanafav, he should not reveal the corner of the garment of the father. What does that mean? Kanaf shira of legal, that the garment, the corner of the garment that his father saw, which means to say that he was intimate with a woman, legal, you shouldn't reveal. That's how we see that it's forbidden in anusas of. It says you might about anusas. How do you know kanaf shira of him? Where does it say in the weird that it's talking about the father, the woman that he seduced or that he raped? How do you see that from the intimacy that the kanaf shira of? So the Gemara, because the chesim elevate the kron. What does it say right before then in the pasuk? It says the previous parasha talks about v'nosne. It's the parasha psukim right before that. It says v'nosne isha sheichevi malavi anarach mishim kesem. Talks about that the woman, that the man who laid with the woman is going to have to give to the father the girl 50 silver coins because that's from the parasha of Einus. Oh, and right after that it talks about leigal kanaf of him. So you see that it must be talking about. Kanaf shira of must be talking about what we said before about oinus, that you see that the Torah is telling you not to marry the woman that the father was ma'anus. I said the Gemara Rabbanan, what do they do? Why do they say it's permitted to marry this woman? They say, look, you have a summer's like if it would be right next to that pasuk of oinus, that would be like you're saying, and we would agree. But hashdulay summer's like now that it's not right near it, because it before the words leigal kanaf of, as we read two lines before, it says leikach esheshav. That's in between. That's a father's wife. That's nothing to do. That's a stepmother. That has nothing to do with Oinus or with Kanaf Ovim. So that's interrupting. So then it can't be that, oh, could you have Kanaf Ovim near Oinus? Not near it. So you can't make a drasha of Simuchin. So rather they hold that Legal Kanaf Ovim is teaching you something else like that of Ravana. So Ravana Mishamali says, Mishamachas Yom Shalav, because of the Pasuk told him, what does it mean Legal Kanaf Ovim? What's that Issa coming to? It's not telling you Issa and Nusa, because that's actually permitted. Come tell you that you're not allowed to marry the woman that's waiting for Yibim with your father. My Kanaf Avim, why it's called Kanaf Avim? Kanaf Avim, love of Leigal. The robe that's fit for your father, which is the Shemeres Yavim, that the son is not allowed to marry. Says Gemara, Tevel Mishum Didasa. Why do you have to come on to Shemeres Yavim Shalavim? It's forbidden to because it's his aunt. It's his uncle's, it's his father's brother's wife. Says Gemara, you're right, Lava Lava Shanei Lavim. It's coming to add on the second Lava. Says Gemara, but it already has a second Lava. Tevel Mishum Yivam Nashuk. We know that a Shemeres Yavim can't marry anyone else besides her husband's brothers, which is this guy's father. So obviously he's not allowed to marry the son. So he's going, well, yeah, lava lava. So that's coming to tell you that you might like 3 lava. Over the same, if you want, you can say, no, it's, you're right, it's not 3 lava. We're talking about la'achar misa. We're talking about after the father died, where there's no ma'issa yivam al-shuk. And you'll explain the pasuk that is talking about the lav of kanaf haroi la'aviv. And as Toy says, well, how is it kanaf haroi la'aviv, the father died? It means that was fit for him when he was alive, and it would have the negative prohibition of the Dasai, but it wouldn't have 3 because it wouldn't have that of Yivam Lashur, because the one Yavam, which was his father, already passed away. But yeah, you would still have those other lot. Now, Ketim Tamid Beis, with the Gemara, has an interesting, a little bit complex, of cases of, which are really, Rashi called them Mishalis. They're like riddles and people were accustomed to saying these types of riddles. Taisa says, all these stories are not really teaching us anything. They're just responses for the tzedukin. The Sadducees like to trip up the Purushim, and they like to make fun of them and say, oh, is this possible? And that we know how to answer these riddles is something valuable. But all these cases, the reason why we're bringing it in is that actually the first one is related to the halacha of our Mishnah we were just discussing. But we're going to bring a bunch of different cases that are a little bit interesting. So it says the Gemara like this. Ach me'av, my brother from my father, V'loy me'em not from the mother, which v'hu ba'la de'em, and he's the husband of my mother. So essentially, is that my paternal brother married my mother. And v'ano brato de'intesir, and I am the daughter of his wife, as Rashi explains. Yaakov raped a woman, gave birth to a daughter. Reuven, who is Yaakov's son from a different woman, married Anusas Aviv, the woman that he raped. And the daughter of Yaakov is saying this statement. How is she saying this? It's her paternal brother. They share the same father, Yaakov, who married my mother because that was Anusas Aviv, Reuven married, and he's the husband of my mother because he married her. So Amar Rami Bar Chama, he says, the liquor Yehuda must need. That's obviously not liquor Yehuda, not Mishnah, meaning he says a man, Reuven, is not allowed to marry Anusas Aviv. This case, the whole case, is obviously not talking about. So this is right. It's not necessary. It's not so difficult to explain this. But this is like, not like we have our Mishnah, because that's obviously, according to the view in the Mishnah, one would not be able to, you see that case? It's not such a difficult case. The other one's actually more difficult. But this is a Reuven, it's from the father of Yaakov. Agapon. It's not such a difficult case. Now it gets a little bit more. Let's follow the cases. Ahu, he's my brother. Ubrihu, and he's my son. Ach se'ano, I'm his sister. Of the haide derina kaspoya, the one I'm carrying on my shoulder. What's this case? How could it be my brother and my son? I'm his sister. I'm the one I'm carrying on my shoulder. Mashkakas, I could have it, but ebi kachav. A non-Jew, because obviously the first case was, he was saying, it's not like Yehuda, but the Mishnah looked at the quarantine, you could have that case. This is by non-Jew, who's obviously doing something that would be forbidden for a Jew. Hapal bitay. He's having relations with his daughter. So what happens? If a non-Jew has relations with his daughter, what happens is that there's a son. That's the baby that this woman's carrying on her shoulder. So that baby is her brother. Why is the baby her brother? Because it's from the same father. It's also her son, because the father had relations with his daughter, and it's her son. So she's the sister of the one she's carrying on the shoulder of her baby. Right? Okay, next case. Shalom aleich bri. Peace unto you, like a greeting, to you, my son. Bas achosechano. I'm the daughter of your sister. What does that mean? So as Yimah Mishkav, so you could have it, but Evi Kachav Mahabal Bas Bita. If a non-Jew has relations with his daughter's daughter, as Rashi explains, and she gives birth to a boy, comes out that this Bas Bita, this granddaughter, is this baby's mother, so it's Shalom Lo Bri, and she's Bas Achaisa. She's the daughter of his sister. Why is she the daughter of his sister? Because the mother of this Bas Bitoi is the sister of her son from the same father. Right? Because this non-Jew had a relation with his granddaughter. This granddaughter's mother was that man's daughter. That means her son, which is from the same Zayda, the Zayda had relations with the Einagel. That means her son is also, has the same father as her mother. Right? Her mother's father was the Zayda. So she's telling her son that, peace to you, my son, I'm also your niece. I'm the daughter of your sister. That's by Avikachavim, that's Baal Bas Bita. Finyas the Gemara, Daloi, which Rashi translate, this means to the workers who water the field, that's the terminology of a pitcher, that lo davlo, that you draw with your pail, I'm going to ask this riddle to. Taisa says from the Aruch, it's referring to the Chacham, who they draw the deep waters from the pits, but they, in other words, they understand everything with wisdom. He says, Lipul b'chu seisur pesem. This falls for you, this puzzling riddle, which is difficult to resolve. It says like this, Tahai didarino, this one that I'm carrying, Hubar, he's the son. Vana, and I am Barasachur. I'm the daughter of his sibling. What's this case? Says Gemara, Mishkachas lo, you could have it. Similar case as the previous one. If a non-Jew has relations with his son's daughter, also granddaughter, but his son's daughter. So essentially, it's the same thing. She's telling her son that I'm also your niece again, but from your brother's son, your brother's daughter. Okay. Next case is Bia Bia. I'm complaining. Me'ach, from a brother. Bu Avan, he's a father. Bu Balan, he's a husband. Bu Barbal, and he's the son of the husband. Okay, so you have to figure out a lot of different things. He's a brother, he's a father, he's a husband, he's the son of a husband. Bu Bala de Aim, and he's the husband of Mami, meaning that he gave birth to me from my mother, which Rashi points out, okay, that's cheap. That's really the same thing as Hu Av, that is the father. We're just trying to add more words, it sounds more colorful when you say that. It's really the same thing as saying he's the father. Vano, and I am Brata de Itze, I'm the daughter of his wife, and still with all these titlin, Beloyov Pitlachu, he doesn't give bread to the brothers that are Yasmi, that are orphans, that are Bnei Brate, that are the sons of his daughter. How do you have such a case? Miskachasla, you could have it, but Ivukachavim Habal Imay. If, a little complex case, a non-Jew has relations with his mother. Ba'ilim and Abbas, he gives birth to a daughter. Okay, not done yet. V'chazah ba'alis Abbas. Then, he has relations with that daughter. So he was with his mother, he had a daughter. Then he has with that daughter. V'chazah zaken, now he's not the only player over here. He gets this from his father, this man. V'chazah zaken. Then the Zayde, the father of this Noyev, he goes in ba'al leha. He has Bia with that daughter.
The granddaughter.
V'haylu men abanim. And then he has sons from her. Okay. So Rashi explains. So this daughter is saying on her father like this. First of all, he is her maternal brother. Right? Because, why is he her maternal brother? Because they share the same mother. This Noyev was with his mother, and that's how he had his daughter. So she's telling her father, first of all, you're my brother. He's also her father, because this Noyev was with his mother having this daughter. He's also her husband, because he was Chazan Bala. He's also Ben Bala. He's also the son of her husband. Why? Because the Zayde went and was born her and had sons. So he's also her husband's son. And that's what, and actually that they were, then they became orphaned. And that's what she's complaining, so to speak, when it says, La'achua Yasmi b'nei brate, to the brothers, the orphans, the sons of his daughter, was referring to the sons of the Zayde. That he gave birth from her, which are paternal brothers and the sons of his daughter. And that's where he's complaining that he left us without anything. That's that riddle. Another case, Anova At, me and you are Achi, we're siblings. Anova Avach, me and your father, also Achi, we're siblings. Anova Imach, me and your mother, Achi, we're also siblings. How is this? The non-Jew gets married to his mother. and he has two daughters. Because of Allah Chesmen, then he gets married to one of them. And from that one, he has a son. Okay. So the Kariyale, Achse de Ime, and she's calling out his mother's sister is calling to him. And she's telling him to that son, she's telling him, me and you, we're brothers. Why? Meaning we're siblings from the same father. Right? Because the same non-Jew who was Baal Imai had the two daughters, and was Baal one of them. So that son, his aunt, his mother's sister, also shares the same father. Now, me and your mother are also siblings because they have the same father and the same mother. And me and your father are also siblings because they have the same mother, because he was Baal Imai. But this woman could be telling her nephew, we're siblings, your father's my sibling, and your mother's my sibling. Another case. Another at, me and you, Bnei Achi, we are cousins. We are the sons of brothers. Another Avich, me and your father, also Bnei Achi, we're also the sons of siblings. Another Imach, me and your mother, also Bnei Achi, we're also the sons of siblings. Says the Gemara, one final riddle. Don't worry if the Gemara has everything, Shas has everything. We have riddles, we have all types of things, we have stories. This is our version of riddles. So the Gemara, how about Teri Nami Mishkach Islam? In this case, you could even have in a permitted way, not with an Oivik Chum that doing some type of Issa. Again, Reuben Shishle Shtei Bonis. Reuben has two daughters. Okay. Vasa Shimon. Shimon comes along with Nasa Chadim and then marries one of the daughters, which he's allowed to. Vasa Bar Levi, then the son of Levi, a different brother, a son of Levi, comes along with Nasu Chabanai, marries a different one. And that's what the story is. Rekamar Le Bredei de Shimon, the son of Shimon, is telling Labar Bredei de Levi to the grandson of Levi, as Rashi fills in the dots, that me and you, this again, the son of Shimon telling this grandson of Levi, we're Bnei Achi. Why are we the sons of siblings? Because they're both the sons of two sisters. Because if you recall, these are both daughters of Reuven. And the son of Shimon, and meaning Shimon and the son of Levi, married those sisters. So the grandson of Levi and the son of Shimon are the sons of siblings. They're cousins. Okay. When he tells, and the son of Shimon is telling the grandson of Levi, me and your father, who's your father? That's the son of Levi. We're also siblings because they're both from two brothers, from Shimon and Levi. And when he tells him, me and your mother, who's your mother? The daughter of Reuven, we're also the sons of two siblings. That's also true, because they're the daughters of Reuven. And so too is the son of Shimon. And therefore, the son of Shimon is saying, me and your mother are also the sons of siblings. So therefore, it could be that he's telling him that me and you, me and your father, me and your mother, are all the sons of siblings, and that's even in Eifel of that. Okay, now we go to the next Mishnah. Now moving on to how it relates to Geirin, to regarding conference. It says the Mishnah, Hagiyayis, a woman who converted, that her sons converted with her. Now, a lot of times you have this, a family gets inspired, they meet a Jewish couple, and they go to Israel, or whatever, and this non-Jewish couple decides with their family to convert. Says the Mishnah, so these sons, if let's say one of them would die without any children, the siblings don't do chalitza, they don't do yibum. Even if the conception, let's say the woman was pregnant when she converted, so the conception of the first one was shalei b'kedusha, which was when the couple was still not Jewish, but they dusted b'kedusha, but she already was Jewish when they gave birth. And the second son was a rasa b'lasa, dusted. Him, the mother was already Jewish when she became pregnant with him and gave birth to him. It doesn't make a difference, because you're missing one step. The halacha of brotherhood is specifically from the father. Now, a ger doesn't have a paternal relationship, because as the Gemara will explain later on, that the Torah declared the seed of a non-Jew like that of a behemoth. Like it says the Pasuk Yecheskel, Bezerma Susim Zeramtam, that their seed is like that of horses. And therefore, the father of the first one, his conception, which is from the father, was when they were not Jewish. So there's not going to be any yibachalitza for that brotherhood. Even though the mother was the same for both of them, meaning the pregnancy, the birth, which is dependent on the mother, she was Jewish for both of them. That's not going to help. So too, if let's say a maidservant, she was freed with her sons with her, which the halachic equivalent of geiris is going to be the same thing. Says the Gemara introduced something that's going to relate back to halacha and Mishnah. B'nei Yudan, the sons of Yudan, who was an amsa, was a maidservant, that was her name, ishtachar, the sons were freed. So Shara Lahu Rav Acha Bar Yaakov, Rav Acha Bar Yaakov permitted leminsav nashe dahadadi. He permitted the men that were freed, now that they became Jewish when they were freed, to marry the brother's wife. Now, says Rashi, we're not talking about because one of them died on the children with the halacha of Yibam. No, even if they had children, he holds that there's no relationships for a ger. Therefore, the brothers are like cut and Chanel dummy. They're unrelated. It's like a regular guy, but if he divorces his wife, the brother is allowed to marry his wife. So only Rabbi says to Rav Acha Bar Yaakov, he says, how could you say the bar of Shesha Sasa, Rav Shesha, it's forbidden? Somebody said to him, okay, who asked Rav Nasharim? He said forbidden, and I said forbidden. We disagree. So the Gemara actually explains and qualifies their machlekes. Min ha'av, if they're paternal brothers, they only have the same father. B'lo min ha'aim, they don't have the same mother. Kulam ala plegat d'shari, no one's going to disagree that, of course, they would be permitted to marry each other's wives. Because again, they only have a paternal relationship, and by non-Jewish paternity is nothing. Now, min ha'aim b'lo min ha'av. Let's say they only share the same mother, not the same father. Actually, kulam ala plegat d'shari, no one's going to disagree that actually would be forbidden. So Rashi explains this, we'll see later on. It might be confused with a regular Yisrael, because we know they have the same mother, and there is a maternal relation, because we see that it comes out of the same womb. Obviously, that we would say that they would be forbidden to marry each other's wives. Kipligi, their dispute was min ha'av min ha'aim. They have the same father and the same mother. What's the machlokes? The Gemara explains. Man d'shari, the one that says that it's permitted, yes, because basar av b'shadina. We go based on the father. Why? The b'nei palan yikaru, what do people call them? They say, oh, vem is bista. Mezuk t'tat is numen. They say, oh, he's Jack's son. So therefore, no one's going to entertain to say, oh, that they're maternal brothers. And they're going to know the reason why they're permitted to marry each other's wives is because there's no paternity, there's no brotherhood from the father for a ger. Because again, generally, a non-Jewish woman is mezana, it's from a different man. There's no paternity for a non-Jew. So that's why it's permitted. Even though they do share the same mother, but no one's going to realize that. Whereas Rav Sheshes, he holds Karlu Nami B'nei Polonis. No, he says that they also call him the son of that woman. And people are going to say, oh, so these guys are brothers. And you see he's permitted to marry his brother's wife, they might come to permit the same thing by Jews, and therefore he held that even if they have the same father and same mother, it would also be forbidden for the game to marry each other's wives. That's one version. Bikadamra, though, are those that say a different version. Polig Rav Acha Bar Yaakov. Actually, Rav Acha Bar Yaakov disagreed. Afilu b'acha min ha'aim, even if the maternal brothers and only maternal brothers, even over there he held that it's going to be permitted for the game to marry the brother's wives. My time, what's the reason? Well, because Geshen is a convert that converts to Kagan Shadal. He's like a brand new person. He's not related to his brother, and therefore he's not concerned for this Gezerah, and therefore he says, yeah, they allow to marry their brother's wives. Now, however, it's not. We learned in the Mishnah, and this is why we introduced it. We're going to ask him, Rabbi Chaim Yaakov. He said in the Mishnah, Hagiyerush and Iskeru B'nei Ma. It's a little complex, but when the woman converts, and her family, her sons, convert with her, the Lachal we said is Loi Chaltim L'Meyah. There's no Chalitza, and there's no Yibam. Wait. My time, why are you not doing Yibam? Says the Gemara, La Mishum Da Asiri, isn't it because it's forbidden because of the brotherhood? Meaning, Mishnah is telling us that there's no mitzvah of Yibam. Okay, there's no mitzvah of Yibam because, you're right, that goes based on the brothers from the same father. That's we know the Achva Achva and the Yaakov. It has to be paternal brothers. But then why are you not allowed to do Yibam? Obviously, because there's an Isra Eishas Ach that remains. There's no Mitzvah Yibam, but then you remain with Eishas Ach. Wait a second, there's an Isra Eishas Ach? Rav Acha Bar Yaakov said that there's no Isra, you're allowed to marry. They're like not related to this Kagut and Chanel dummy. You see in that Mishnah, obviously it's forbidden. It's like, well, no, you're reading the Mishnah wrong. It's not saying that it's forbidden to do Yibam. It just means the Ein B'Teiches Chalitza B'Yibam. There's no halachic obligation not of Chalitza, not of Yibam, because they're not brothers at all. But of course, Rishai Lam, they're allowed to marry whoever they want. And in the Mishnah, they're also allowed to marry. Which is like Rav Acha Bar Yaakov. But no, the reading doesn't sound well, says the Gemara, because we can tell you the words in the Mishnah were afilu. The words in the Mishnah were that lo chayitz v'lo me'avin, and the next words were even if the pregnancy of the first one was shalom b'kedusha, even though the birth was b'kedusha, and the second one was both the pregnancy and the birth was b'kedusha, no, still there's no chayitz not yibam. So the Gemara explains, and there's actually two versions of this. If you say that when the Mishnah says lo me'avin, what it's coming to say is asiri, as we had thought in our question, that it's forbidden for them to do yibam, because again, it is eishes ha'av. I don't feel I can understand that it says even. What's even? You want to explain it. The avagav did, because there's something different in the mother. The avagav did yishun, even though the first boy, hayirasah shalei b'kedusha, v'leidasah b'kedusha, his pregnancy, yes, she conceived him when she wasn't Jewish, but the birth was when she was already Jewish. Vashena, the second one's hayirasah v'leidasah b'kedusha, the second one, the conception and the birth was when she was holy. Now, what's the significance of that? U'kashtei imay is dumb. So essentially, it's like really two different mothers. Why is it like two different mothers? Because the woman was not Jewish, and then she was Jewish. The first one she conceived when she wasn't Jewish. The second one was she was Jewish. So you might have thought to say that, like they're unrelated. And therefore, you would think, okay, if you want to do Yim, you can do Yivim. And that's the chiddush I could understand that the Mishnah is saying, Afalach Yisir, even so, that's not filler, even so, it's going to be Asir, because it is Eishas Achim. That's only if you're saying that Lim Yab means it's Asir to do it. But Eli Yam, if you say like you're trying to answer, that the Mishnah is not coming to tell us anything, but rather, no Isir, but rather Shahu, that it's permitted for her to marry whoever she wants to, because no mitzvah Yibim, and it would even be for the brothers. So Maya filler, then what's the even? It sounds like that even though the woman's like two different women, because the first one she wasn't Jewish when she conceived, that okay, even so she can be permitted to marry whoever she wants to. What do you mean? Regarding Yivam Lashok, doesn't make a difference to us if they have the same mother or not. There's no shaykhis to mitzvah Yivam. The Eishas Achah does. But the Yivam doesn't. So it sounds like we're asking that not like Rav Acha B'Yakov, that actually the Gerim are forbidden in their brothers. Says Yivam, no. Mishnah is coming to tell us the Avagav the Tavai, although both of them lay dust in Be'kedusha, the birth was in the state of Kedusha. And therefore what? The Avagav is not going on the Hayrasah Shalei B'kedusha. It's going on the lay dust in Be'kedusha. So even though both of them were born when the mother was Jewish, and therefore Va'asa Echluv B'Yisrael, it might come to be confused with regular Jewish brothers, and you might come to permit a Yevam L'Shuk Burat Chalitza. That's what we're saying, Afalach Yishari. Even so, it's going to be permitted for her to marry whoever she wants to, because everyone knows that Yibam is because that they have the same father, and by non-Jews they don't have any paternity. But, as Rashi explains, that would be specifically to marry whoever she wants to from somewhere else. But for the brothers, right, Rav Acha agrees that even the curse of Eishes Ach would be over there, because since the birth was B'Kedushim, so then you do have maternal brotherhood. And when Rav Acha was answering that for them, it's also going to be permitted, Rashi explained, it was only going under Reisha. And even when they birth with Shalabik, they should be not on the safe. That's a Rashi qualifies that. That's one version. Nikitam, those who want to say what we just said, the exact opposite. That actually, we're not asking for our Mishnah and Rabbi Yaakov, but actually, Hachanam is Tabr. We're saying actually, it's logical Rabbi Yaakov from our Mishnah that the Shahu, when we're saying that Eim Yabim doesn't mean that you're not allowed to, means you don't have to do, but that you're permitted to marry. Because like Tani Afilu, we said Afilu. What do you mean Afilu? So this version is saying the exact opposite. Yeah, Rabbi Shalabik, if you say like what the Gemara answered for Rabbi Yaakov, that when we're saying that there's no chalitza yibam, it doesn't mean you're not allowed to, it means that you don't have to do it, that she's permitted to. So I don't feel that's what means afilah. Meaning, what's afilah? The avagav the davayla does make the even though that both in the birth was when the mother was Jewish, does love to be so, might be confused with a regular Jewish person. Afilah, sure, even though it's even so, it's going to be permitted because we're not going to make the confusion. That makes sense, afilah. Eliyamad Asiba, if you say like the question I wanted to say that below me out means that you're not allowed to do yibam, that we're trying to say that it's going to be forbidden on the brother, my afilah, what's the afilah? As Tosis explains, that since the birth of the first one was B'Kedusha, so then he's similar to a full-fledged brother that's more similar to a Yisrael, to the contrary. It's more obvious when the lay doesn't is B'Kedusha. So why would you say Afilah? No, the Avagav Derishin, it's the other part of that variable. The Avagav Derishin, Hayrasa Shalei B'Kedusha, even though the first one of the conception was not in the state of sanctity, even though the lay does B'Kedusha, even though the birth was in the state of Kedusha. Bashin, the second one, does Kiddusha, the conception and the birth was in state of Kiddusha, and different, you might say like the mother was like two different mothers, and different might not be confused, and different should be permitted. Not for law, even so it can be forbidden. Therefore, that's that version of the Raya. So the Gemara says, let's bring a Raya like Rav Sheshes regarding this Machlekes, if the brothers are forbidden or not. Right, it says, Shnei Achim Tu'umim Geir. If you have two brothers that are twins that converted, so too, let's say they were slaves that were freed, which obviously these are paternal brothers, because the Gemara later on, the Tzadik Chazam Alaf tells us that the twins are one droplet, the identical twins, which splits into two. Even so, says the Braisa, there's no chalitza and there's no yibam, and there's no liability for the brother's wife, even if they got engaged after they converted, because like we said, Gishon's got a congenital, and therefore there's no brotherhood, even from the mother. Now, let's say the woman conceived when she wasn't Jewish yet, but she gave birth when she's really Jewish, then there's no chalitza and no yibam. Because again, the element of Yibam is from the father, and we say that they don't have a father because, again, the seed of a non-Jew is like that of a behemoth. Abu Chayavim, but they would be Chayav Karas, Mishum Eishasach, because of the fact that they're the same mother, because she was Jewish when she gave birth to the sons. I said, now, let's say she was pregnant and gave birth to both of them when she was already Jewish. Of course, they're like regular Jews for all halachas. Autonomy is one thing, says the Gemara, we learned in the Reisha that when she gave birth, Shaloi Begdusha, first case, we said in chayav b'shem eshesach. There's no liability for eshesach. Sounds like says the Gemara, chayuv alekah. There's not going to be any liability of cars. Let's say the tin that sounds like chesam and aleph, but haysur ikar sounds like that there would be a prohibition at least rabbinically, which is the halacha we keep on saying that you shouldn't confuse with a Jewish person. Well, that's the difficult Rav Chava Yaakov who says that no problem. They like a gerusha. This guy sounds like Rav Sheshes. The Gemara no. Well, the nothing like not like the truth is there's not even the iser. I did my limits to say, because I wanted to say the next case of Leidos and Bekedusha, that we said Abachayim, and then they would be Chayv Karas because of Eshazach, even there's no Yibin Chalitza, because that's regarding the mother, that's regarding the father. Tamar Reisha, in Chayim, so we said in Chayim, but really it's not even that, on Chayim, it's not even an Isser. So that could even be like Rebbech B'yak. Now, the Gemara just makes one last qualification, Omer Rav. It says, Hodam and Rav, this the rabbi say, Ain Avla Mitzri, that there's no fatherhood for an Egyptian, even a non-Jew, that even when you can't say, Kakut and Chanel Dami, for example, let's say the conception was Shalei B'Kedusha and the birth was B'Kedusha, which we say they do have a relation from the mother, like a regular Jew, because they were both, the mother was Jewish when they gave birth, and there's no paternity from the father. Loi Tema, don't say the reason is Mishum D'Shtufi B'Zima, because, oh yeah, non-Jews, they're steeped in immorality. The Loi Yediya, which you don't know who the father is, and that's why we say that there's no paternity. Avu Yediya, but let's say we knew. For example, let's say the mother and father were locked in prison, that there's no one else that was a possibility that had to be with her. Then maybe Chashim would be concerned, and therefore, if the mother gave birth in the state of Kedusha, which you cannot take a cut in Chanel, maybe we'd say that it would also be considered a paternal relationship, because for sure it's from the same father. No. Even if we know who the father is, we're not concerned with the paternity. Why? Because Rashnei Akam Tum, we quoted this before, you have two twin brothers, the Tiba Achasayah was one droplet. The Nethlashlam is split into two, because I say, what do we learn in the Sefer? There's no Chalitz not Yibam. Which as Rashi points out, we're learning it from the Sefer. Because from the Reisha, you wouldn't be able to learn it out because there you don't even have maternal relationship, because even the birth was Shalei B'Kedusha. And the reason is not because of, as the Gemara is going to say, of Zer Mesusim Mesusim, it's rather because of Kekot Janel Demi. But from the Sefer, where we know it's from the same mother and the same mother, the father, still is no Chalitza Na'ibim. Shema Menor, what we've learned from this is Afkuri Afkir Dachmon Lazari. It's just because the Torah declared the seed of the non-Jew ownerless. So he says, the Pasuk Yecheskel, Besar Chamar and Besar, their flesh is the flesh of donkeys. The Zirmas, which is the seed, which is, it shoots forth like an arrow, which is like the flow of the water, which flows with force, is Susim, the flow of the horses, Zeramtam is their force, and therefore, again, even if we know who the father is, the Akum don't have considered that their seed, even if we knew who it is. Thank you for any time. Close to us.